Now every gambler knows the secret to surviving is knowing what to throw away, knowing what to keep. 'Cause every hand's a winner.
And every all right, welcome to the Dip of My Thread. Such a good time. And it was for free. You weren't even hearing all our jokes. Here we are to talk about spring 1903, but you know, Hand couldn't make it for the last show, and he hasn't even bothered to, I'm sure, listen to our show. I don't even know if he's seen the current moves, but I will tell you that on this show, Keith really predicted an AR. He predicted an English stab of Russia in the spring, and I predicted a French stab in the spring.
No,
English stab of Russia. In the fall.
I said England won't stab Russia until he sees if France is going to stab him first.
Maybe it was wordy. I predicted a French stab of England.
Okay, also, I'm the one. I predicted the AR. Me. It wasn't Keith. It was me 2 turns ago. I had to interrupt you guys. You guys were like, you guys and Andre were just, I had to struggle to even get a word in about the AR. And I proclaimed Lowry, the people's champ. You don't remember that? You don't even remember the cool things I say, Ed. What the hell?
All right. Well, I only look at Conk because he's my hero.
We know.
So, all right. Look, we have the spring 1903 moves, guys, and we'll get into these moves here. They got so much to talk about. But before we talk about the moves, I'm going to stop sharing. I'm going to share. The competitors are meta-ing everybody. Here's the first thing I'm going to share with you from my Discord. Here's what Bradley wrote to Wardy. Thanks for that anti-me propaganda, by the way. And yes, I know it was a mistake. Bold agrees. You can quote this on the Diplomat. When AR stab and hand the game to Jordan and Riaz on a silver platter. I'm more mad at my own mistake. Sometimes it only takes one, but I like having something else to blame. Russia stabbing me for just a 50-50 and to get Austria, Greece, Wardy. It's a dumb, dumb play. You could quote that too. So Wardy sent that to me, which got from Grayson, presumably before this came out. What do we think about that? What do we think about Grayson seeing his move to Greece was cause of his demise in spring 1903?
It's not very classy. I mean, I will say this.
Period. Next subject.
Every single time I've stabbed someone, you know what that, if they're, especially if they're a high ego player, I've been called an idiot, you know? I'm sure you know this feeling. You stab someone, their first message to you, you idiot!
Yeah. Like how,
you know, it's, of course, it always seems so dumb and so, you know, but it, so it is kind of funny. I will say this, Grayson, why are you meta-ing Wardy? He immediately leaked to Ed, and I'm not even going to say the names, but there are some young champions, you know, on our Nexus seasons that were talking to me throughout the game, and I never once leaked to my fellow cast members, to people outside. You know, I gave them advice all the way through. You know, I held their hand. You know, it's not even advice, but it's more of a, I supported them emotionally, you know. And I'm actually a bit outraged that I have not received one meta message this season. You know, it might be, okay, I didn't comment that much on Olympus Season 1. Maybe I did a little damage to my brand. But, you know, even Stitch has got a message from Riaz saying, Yorkshire forever. Okay. And I've not one meta message. And, you know, it's usually the young guys, you know, who are sending me stuff. So, Lowry, what the hell? I proclaim you people's champ. You know, the AR that I so, you know, presciently predicted 2 seasons ago is coming to fruition. So, you know, I'd like to hear a little something. I'm supporting you here. I mean, no, it's just lonely. Like, if you're gonna meta, like, do it through the meta master, the moral metacist. Like, come on, guys.
And that's such a plea for attention.
Absolutely.
When I was playing and in the heat of battle in 1907, Cedric texted me at one point and said, "You know, I'm not really paying attention to the game. I just fast forward through it, and your moves are incomprehensible." So, thanks for the support. When I needed the moral support.
When was that?
A couple years ago. I got nothing. I got nothing from you. And
you need the stick.
This is actually one of the great things about the game. I think this is this sort of evolved in like season 4 or 5 when Conk broke the fourth wall. I did it in season 2, but Conk broke the fourth wall and started blasting players publicly on the Nexus server. I don't know if you guys remember. That's when he pulled out the sock puppet for the first time. We're starting to see that now. But we had another conk. I don't know if it's not a meltdown, but this
Topsy.
Okay, I didn't even understand this.
I will say, can I just vent about, scroll up a little bit here? Because I really feel Conk here. So here, Conk is trying to post his rants and his metaing, and Riaz interrupts him with a lame gif. I hate this. Like, Umbel would always do this to me. I had this, like, amazing, like, long diatribe, and he posts a lame gif that interrupts the flow. Like, Riaz, frankly, like, I wouldn't be surprised if Conk attacked him just for this, you know? Like, just putting a dumb gif right in the middle of this touching, beautiful story about this poor little elephant, you know, who, you know, entertained us, who made us laugh, who made us cry, and then it was just put to death, electrocuted, and exploded for our amusement. You know, but I really do wonder, though, Stitches, I know you didn't read this because you say you only read the first and last message sentences of Conk Press, but and maybe you, who is a little bit more of a Conk fan like me.
I just looked at the pretty pictures, so thanks, Rhea.
What do you guys think? Do you think is Topsy a metaphor for a certain power, or is it deeper than that?
Well, he said that the French did dedicate their 1903 to Topsy the elephant. I mean,
it's Topsy Germany.
I don't know. It was beyond me. Sometimes it's like one of my favorite movies is the movie Risky Business, and the mob guy is talking to the prostitute who's talking to Tom Cruise, and they're like, "How much for the artsy fartsy thing?" And that's, I looked at this and I was like, it's kind of artsy fartsy for me. I don't know if I get it.
Ed, I gotta tell you though, Conk, he is diplomacy shredded right now. Like, I've been playing, he's been in the speedboat arena like almost nightly, just hitting that speed bag, like getting his aggression out, just in tip top shape. His meta, his meta is also on point. I mean, this Topsy thing is funny, but what I really liked is if you go to the public forum, he starts asking, does anyone really play for second in the final? And did you guys see that? He said, question, does anyone really play for second in the finals? It was under the guise of challenging the Olympus quirk that you get seeded by your semifinal rank, not the finals, because they don't want people to be basically selling off places for DBNI points, which was, if you guys recall, a scandal in the last Nexus finals, I believe. Though it was actually more complicated than that, right? I mean, for listeners who aren't familiar with this, there was a big scandal in the last Nexus Finals because allegedly Riaz had promised Jackson second place for his DBNI points, and then everyone on the board was outraged, and it caused quite a lot of anti-Riaz sentiment. But in my opinion, it kind of turned out that Jackson actually just said that to kind of tilt the board against Riaz, where he had no intention at all of playing for second.
Now, Jackson said that. He admitted.
Oh, did he? Yeah. Brilliant, by the way. What a smart kid. You know, I love that. But it's interesting that Conk would bring that back up, right? Is he kind of reigniting the anti-Riaz tilts here by saying that? I mean, is he insinuating that Riaz is the godfather, is once again trying to sell a second place to someone, or what's going on here?
Well, who's Topsy? Who's poor Topsy?
I was thinking, is it him? Is it an autobiographical look? Does Conk feel like the entertaining elephant who gets in the finals and gets electrocuted for fun? I mean, or maybe it's a metaphor of all the painful lessons he's learned in the past. I don't know.
Cedric, we see a great view of your fingerprint.
My fingerprint? Oh my God, are you serious?
What? No, that's your dog. Good dog, though.
Oh, I see. I've got my finger on there. Thank you. It is a good dog. Fortunately, I'm at my parents' house, so I'm just having to have to hold up a tablet to my face right now.
All right. We start in the East, where all the action, the interesting action, has been. I have so many questions, even though it sort of looks straightforward, like it's just an AR stab here of Turkey. But clearly, do we agree that Turkey knew this was coming?
Yeah, he either saw the writing on the wall one way or the other. Someone told him, or he just didn't get enough press to feel comfortable. But he was able to not negotiate something in his favor, and they were not good enough liars to conceal the stab. So it's going to be a little harder to grind him out with that comment.
I think it would be, I was actually, so did you guys not consider the fact, you guys assumed that the Greece-Bulgaria exchange was arranged?
Yeah.
But why? Yes.
Even Grayson said it was arranged.
Even Grayson said it was arranged.
Oh, did he? Because to me, I thought it was probably arranged, but it seemed like a little bit like tapping gone wrong. Like, you know, in the sense that Grayson taps Greece to make sure there's nothing shady. Like they tried, like Austria flips to Italy. Yeah, but, you know, if Austria tried to flip with Italy here, they could have taken the Aegean. So he taps Greece, but then Austria thinks one fold ahead and taps Bulgaria back and everything slides forward. But if Grayson straight up admitted it, there's no way that Grayson's, you know, pressed you guys could be false. So
he just wanted things to be as easy for everyone else to trust him. And then he put himself on the chopping block in the way. So
he played with heart. Keith, he played the Keith way. And look what happened.
He actually did, yeah. He didn't foster enough trust, I guess.
Do you guys think that this is the best way for Austria and Russia to attack Turkey? I almost think Bulgaria had to move to Khan. So what if he doesn't take Greece now? He'll still have Trieste, Albania, and he could get it in the spring, and he could maybe, you know, strain the army. But the army back on Khan is not a big problem, but it's a problem. I mean, it's going to be harder to grind them out.
Yeah, I would have walked to Khan.
I think, I mean, you guys are being really good-hearted about this. But to me, I think there's a huge disparity in I know a lot of people really like Russia's play, but to me, there's a huge disparity in Russia and Austria's play. I think it's a brilliant move by Austria. Yeah, having an army in Khan is a huge problem for Russia to get their part of the split, right? But Austria is picking up what they need. He's getting up to 7. Austria's moves to me are very near perfect. My biggest worry when I saw Austria take Venice is that Austria would try to press on against Italy, right? Because Venice is a center as Austria you can actually hold. With Austria, when you get bogged down is when you try to take the other centers, which first of all can't be held from land without considerable sea power and are really hard to take. So he did really good here. Kept an army in Vienna, which is like the kind of defensive linchpin of Austria, kind of seems neutral, moved in a way that he can hold on to Greece. I find no fault at all in Austria's moves. I actually really like them, and I'm feeling pretty confident that Lauri and his Puka, you know, it might be Puko knife. I need to look this up. It might be Puko knife, but I'm glad that
Austria hasn't messaged you to correct you yet.
I know. I really want him to.
Well, you're really into the Finnish language. You sent us that clip of a Finnish NBA player speaking Finnish, and it was like the most incomprehensibly long language for the smallest words or shortest words. It was hilarious.
Yes. I mean, the Finnish language is actually very fascinating. I almost just launched into a long monologue about linguistics, but I don't think that's why people are here, so I won't go into it. But yeah, like, you know, to your question, Ed, I haven't seen this particular way of attacking Turkey, but it is quite nice, right? I mean, Austria is going to have to get another fleet build soon. Otherwise, there's going to be no way to take Italy down without Turkey. However,
I'm thinking they retreat to Tunis and then that disband, they could always rebuild.
Well, he opened up Trieste just for that fleet build.
And to defend Greece, but it's great because, you know, I think we actually talked about this maybe in the first year or two, but, you know, you kind of need it. One of the reasons Italy can play is that people need them to unlock Turkey, but they've managed to set up the board. They can maybe unlock Turkey without Italy.
I'm going to say I like the move. I mean, you really convinced me. First you did, Keith, then Cedric, and then Keith drove the point home in the last episode that AR really had to form. There was no place else for Russia to grow. My concern about Russia doing it was if he's going to get stabbed in the north, he had no enemies, and then he was going to make two. But it's even better for Russia, and I love Russia even further now because I don't think England's going to be calling on him right now.
I like the AR. I will say, so I actually recently ran my first AR, and I was, you know, I had AR PTSD from the Nexus Season 3 finals that really stuck in me for a while. I ran my first successful AR recently, and it exceeded even the speed with which you can roll the board is staggering. It's incredible. So, and I really like the AR. I don't like Russia's play, though. There's so many things I don't like. You know, first of all, he's either lucky or he's in on and not being a very good ally to France's attack on England. I'm not sure if I phrased that very clearly. But what I mean by is, I mean, I'll have to touch on this again when we move to England. But, you know, I don't really see why he feels like he needs to leave Scandinavia so vulnerable. I don't really like the Moscow builds at all, because first of all, it's also kind of threatening to Austria. You're not actually treating your ally very well. I think building a fleet would have really been a sign that I'm all in on this plan, especially, you know, I hate to sound like a broken record, but a South Coast fleet would have been pretty cool.
We said that.
Oh, did you? Yeah. I mean,
give that.
Yeah.
We really graded Russia down for the Moscow build.
Okay, yeah, I agree with that a lot. And it's not just tactically, the Moscow build isn't bad, because an army in Moscow is never bad for Russia because it can move in any direction. But when you have a really tight AR here, just kind of if he had built a fleet, or I think that it would have made Austria a lot more comfortable about also building a fleet. And the thing is, when you only have one center that can build a fleet, and you don't have a fully naval ally in the south or north, you need to be pumping those fleets out through your one center, because it's not like you can just, it's not like England, who can maybe just chance upon a triple build or something and build three fleets at once. So I really didn't like that. Though there is something to be said for just the hold in Moscow as a neutral, but I can deploy in any direction kind of thing.
Yeah, I see that. I mean, I'm really sort of curious as to what you, I'm back and forth a million times on whether Silesia should have gone to Berlin, Baltic port. I think what he's concerned of here is losing Silesia, but he could have bounced that with Moscow if that happened.
If he would have done that move, then, yeah, I mean, Munich goes to Silesia, it just walks in, and Berlin retreats to Prussia. That's a little rough. I figured he was going to take it in the fall anyway.
So, you're right. I didn't anticipate the Berlin retreat. What do you think about Conk here not taking Holland? He's stabbing England. Presumably, this is a stab of England. I can't read it any other way. But he doesn't go for Holland when he knows what's going to happen. And Conk is better than all of us tactically. He knows this isn't the right way to take Munich. And he kept this for position. But, like, what are we thinking? Why?
And I'm not of your philosophy of self-sandbagging constantly. So please, like, can you ask for my permission?
You don't think Conk is better than us?
Mm-hmm. I just don't play enough.
Okay, but he's really good.
I bet you my per-game record is better than Conk's, but sure, I'll give you this. So people don't think I'm ego or anything, you know.
I'll beat him in face-to-face if he ever showed up. But on an online thing, even though I have beaten him, I think he's a better player. I think... Why doesn't he go Ruhr to Munich here? Because he wants Holland in the fall, do you think? Is that the idea?
I think what happened... So if you're going to stab someone, a lot of people are kind of socially anxious, so they want a friend to stab with them. And then what happens is word gets out. I know that this is maybe not the majority opinion, but I think that if you're going to stab, you should tell no one at all. I don't know if you guys can remember, this is a long time ago now, but Nexus Season 1, the classic, what was the name of the French guy? He was named after leukemia in Season 1. Stitches, help me out here. Leukemia? Oh, his name is literally leukemia, but with L-O-U, right. He had a classic Christmas Day stab, right, where he said his last words were, "I won't stab, I'm too loyal," and then he had the game-winning stab, right? That is the way to do it, because especially with players this level, the word's going to get out. And if you stab in a way that makes someone vulnerable, right, there's blood in the water, people are going to come to you anyway. So I thought about this a lot, right? I think that he just simply doesn't trust the other powers enough to let them in on the secret here. I will say, though, what did Germany do to these guys? I mean... Like, the fact that, like, you know, Conk would actually attack England and would still not communicate with Germany enough to avoid Ruhr getting tapped and would still attack Munich? I mean...
Yeah. He would rather not get Holland and force disband Kiel. That's saying a lot about Germany.
Yeah, it's wild.
I said on the last show, if Germany survived, he would get a grade better than F. And I think Germany's going to survive. Maybe. Kiel obviously has to be disbanded. I think even in this configuration, probably Munich and Berlin can go, depending on what happens with Kiel. But I think Germany can make it to 04.
Maybe, but I mean...
For what, a participation trophy?
It doesn't seem like anyone's willing to work with them at all. I mean,
what did Nick
even
do?
He's
a nice guy.
Is he?
Yeah,
he's
guess.
A nice guy.
Didn't I call him like a toddler with knives last season?
All right. A couple toddler other
with Listen, toddlers with knives are nice. They don't know what the knives do. You know, just because they've tripped and the knife went into you, this is the Ed special, doesn't mean that they meant the knife to go into you.
I was just flicking it around.
You're just playing.
It just went in you. I don't know. Sorry.
This is just a big baby gate, so it's containing Germany.
We also have, not only does Turkey know, I'm just flopping around with questions that I have here, things that I'm sure our competitors have thought through way more than we have, but they are really putting Austria to the test here on whether to retreat to Tunis or not, right? They know that's a potential. Austria has a potential retreat to Adriatic, to Apulia, or Tunis. I think that's it. If he goes to Tunis, he won't keep it, right? There's no way to keep it, but it means Adriatic is safe, I would
assume. Yeah, there's a lot to be said for Tunis. It pins Italy down in the sense that he needs to use Tunis to move it. And then you get if you want, you can retreat somewhere. You know, you get your units forward in a way that, like, you know, he could kind of have an excuse to retreat to West to claim that he's fighting Italy while putting a little pressure on France while building goodwill with England because of that pressure that's plausibly deniable, et cetera, et cetera. But it's a really tough choice because defensively, it would be nice to be in the Adriatic and to know that nobody can get in there.
I'd go to Apulia. Naples is open. They'd have to block it with one unit. And then most likely, if you get Greece, you could always build Fleet Trieste, and that helps you pull one right into the Adriatic.
Yeah, and it also keeps Italy from loading two against Venice that way, too.
Mm-hmm. It's defensive, too. I wouldn't go to Adriatic just because I'd want to build another fleet to pull out, and I think I'd just box myself in.
It's a tough thing. I would say in a normal game, I would probably retreat to Tunis because I love retreats. I love retreats because it's a free move. You get to move two tiles in one year, in one season, if you get a retreat, right? And I'm always looking to move to get free moves and to, you know, increase the value of that unit by getting it farther out. However, in a game of this caliber, where you're trying really to get to 8 or 9 centers, not get to 12 or 18, I think you might be right. And Apulia is the move, but we'll see.
Now, Tunis is the first thing I saw. I was like, that's great, because it ties up Italy for the entire season. You don't have to worry about it. But the retreats are awful. And if you want to build a second fleet, all you're going to either do is disband and only build one, or you're going to have one locked on the other side, which isn't awful either. West tapping Tunis the entire game keeps one fleet locked up there, too. Spanish option as well. But
let me give a potential reason why you retreat to Tunis other than what we're saying, which is if you're going to Tunis because of the Eastern Med ship there, almost like Austria, I mean, that Italy has to risk the Ionian to Tunis back, you know, because the mover theoretically, if it's Tyrrhenian is the mover, then Ionian might be able to get cut and Tunis could be kept. So if Ionian is moving to Tunis with Tyrrhenian support, Eastern Med can then slip into Ionian that way. I don't think that any of that's going to happen. So maybe I overthought it. Maybe it is Apulia.
Honestly, it's not. I wouldn't say there's a right. I'd say it's pretty much like.
They're both great options.
It's like 40 Tunis, 40 Apulia, 20 Adriatic for me.
Meanwhile, other thing that Cedric said that he thought Austria's moves were sort of perfect. I do not like the self-bounce in Tyrolia. Why is this a good move?
Well, it's a good move. What would you rather he have done, I guess?
He's just worried that if Russia does the tram and goes into Bohemia or Galicia, he has a unit back because everything's away from Budapest right now.
That's the only explanation I can come up with. But I'd almost... He's not making peace with Greg. AR is not making peace with Italy. So,
right.
So Vienna, Tyrolia seems to have a lot of value to me.
Well, no, because you want, otherwise Budapest, Russia is just an absolute free center to walk into Budapest. There's not even the threat of being bounced if you move out of Vienna. The thing about Vienna is think about 1901, right? The Holden, you want to keep an army in Vienna because it's actually the defensive linchpin of Austria, right? And it's not necessarily that he's going to move to Budapest, but just by having an army in Vienna, it makes Russia think twice about just walking into Budapest. You know, at a game of this level, having a free center in the fall is pretty hard to turn down. Like, I really do believe
Russia could give a weird excuse like, well, I was expecting to get something, but now there's an army in Caen and I'm not going to get anything and I might lose Norway. So I'm just
going to
ask later.
Yeah, and the self-balance is nice too, because if Munich had gotten dislodged, the last thing you want is Austria, especially when Venice is yours now, is to have an army bordering three of your centers, right?
Would England have stabbed Russia here had the kill Germany plan gone through, or had there not been this Koch move here? And in other words, did Koch move too early, do you think?
I think he had to, because once England builds that next fleet, I don't think England's going to be easy to stab without France growing enough to build fleets to grind it out. I think he had to be clever here, and I think this is what he needed to do. And I think that was England's best play, is to wait to fall. I think he would have definitely stabbed Russia if France decided to slow play, because that means he's going to pick up Kiel and Norway, drop two fleets, and lock up the North.
Now, I have a theory.
Yeah.
My theory is this. My theory is this was a classic Cedric test, and Cedric here is Riaz. My theory is Riaz told Konk he was moving York to Holland. That's why Konk doesn't attack Holland, because he doesn't know if he'll get it because of what Germany's. But he didn't move there because he wanted to see if Konk would make this move, which was laid up there. We talked about it on the last episode. And the only thing it doesn't do is give him defensiveness over Clyde. But, you know, I think Riaz almost lured this stab into something he can defend. Thought.
I mean, first of all, Ed, I got to give it up to your memory. I can't believe you actually remember that talk when I told you about how I like to do stuff like that. But I will say this. First of all, I need to get this out. Riaz is in the public channel just trotting around talking shit. Be like, see, that's why you keep an army in York, you fools. Okay, bro, if you had a fleet, you could have blocked the move to NAO, and now he has if he feels like it, he can just put an army in Clyde. That's not really that amazing of an outcome, you know. I will say that when you talk about the Cedric test, I don't think I would have done that in a way that invites someone to set up a convoy line onto my island. It's more of I usually do that. The idea of testing someone is in a very low stakes situation. Right.
Wouldn't be able to protect
usually it's a very, very low stakes situation when you're just seeing if they're truthful or not, or if they're just going to turn around and try to manipulate the board against you, or to try to feel out who they're really talking to when mysterious coordinations show up the second you tell them, you know, a little move. So I thought Riaz is, you know, prancing around about how this proves he was so right about saying Yorkshire is, I think, kind of funny. I will say this you've got the difference between, oops, did I mess this up? A regular season and finals board. In a regular game, the payoff of doing this would not be enough. However, right, Riaz is starting to gallop a little bit. Like, who, God knows, Germany seems to be actively throwing to Riaz since the second, you know, year for some reason. I don't know what Konk did to infuriate them, but. You know, Konk can do that sometimes. Maybe send him a picture of a dick sock jumping out of a box or something. Who knows? But the threat, I say this all, the threat of a convoy is as valuable as the convoy itself. The scramble it creates, right? Now Riaz is going to have to pull things back. The army, whether or not he could put the army in Clyde, maybe that army will never take anything, but just having the army threatening two centers until it's forcibly disbanded and can be rebuilt will, you know, put the brakes right on Riaz. I'm kind of shocked that you guys were so convinced he would go against Italy. I mean, what would be the value of that? Just to either, I don't really get it. Like, maybe he could pick up Tunis. You know,
it's just Tunis. That's about all you get.
Yeah, I'm not really totally seeing it, especially since his, you know, the other people scrambling for the centers have a much more forward position than him.
Whoa, I think the theory was this. Greg's mad at Austria because Austria stabs him. If he goes with a scent, which he clearly didn't have, right? But if he goes with a scent to help, and he gets maybe, you know, one or two freebies. I think clearly that's what Riaz wanted to have. Right? Riaz want, you know, every England wants France to commit that.
Well, if Riaz wanted that, the thing is that I see where Conk, you know, super shredded speedboat Conk is what he's thinking here. I mean, in a way, I think I have to say, you know, the one thing I was wrong about, you know, I predicted Lowry being the people's champ. I predicted the back door into England. And the one thing I have to admit I was very wrong about was that I did not see this turning into an ER after Germany supported England and Sweden. And this is not only because I know the Godfather always pays his capos for their work, and I was a little surprised that he didn't, but it was also because I feel like I was surprised that he didn't kind of prop Germany up, especially after Germany helped him as a counterbalance to France.
Very surprised.
You know, I was right. Yeah. And then not only and then on top of that, if you commit against Russia, kind of shows that you're kind of serious about going in a different direction than France, you know, and this is not to say I don't see what Riaz is doing or this play was bad, because one thing I've really learned playing, for some reason I draw England all the time, it's so easy to crush Scandinavia, especially if you built a bunch of fleets whenever you feel like it. Like, I love to magnanimously let other people have those centers. Like, and look at Riaz's position right now. He could take that. He could take Norway and Sweden whenever he feels like it, right? So often it's okay, you know, you let someone else have it, knowing that you can very quickly take Norway, Sweden, even St. Petersburg, right? On the other hand, I think Conk is too smart for that. He sees that reservoir of centers. He knows that he doesn't want Riaz to get to the point where he can take two or three centers all at once and start rolling.
Well, the thing is, Riaz should have seen that also. This Conk drawing the V of supports to Ionian here. You think Riaz didn't want Mid-Atlantic to go to Western Med in this situation? Like, that should have been the clue that he's keeping those fleets there for a reason. And that reason is ambiguity. And that means you're not safe. It's ambiguous by definition.
I just held them there.
On the other hand, though, I mean, it is fair to say, I mean, if he moves out of Mid-Atlantic, then England can just pick up Brest. You know, no problem. There is an there are excuses to stay in Mid-Atlantic, but
you can't play an alliance game without trust.
But Ed,
I think clearly they don't trust each other.
This exact move, I think I said this in 01 because I'm, you know, we all know I love the two G spots, Gascony and Galicia. You know, I love them, and I think I said 01 like drooling. Oh, maybe Conk will move to Gascony, MAO and NAO. Yeah. I'm always amazed how often this works. Like, why, what is it about NAO that people just don't see the value of that tile? It's actually such an important tile. And going back to Riaz's, you know, peacocking around about Yorkshire, you know, I think that there's something to be said for just blocking NAO and being like, this is England's tile if you're going to stay in MAO. I mean,
I feel like it was obvious, so obvious, I suggested York move to Liverpool in the spring, if you remember. Because I think that army build in Marseille told the tale. If
Agreed.
He was going against Italy, he would have built a fleet there. The army made no sense unless it was convoying someone. Four army France's, this just doesn't work unless that fourth army's on the continent.
Absolutely agreed. The second I saw that build, I had that thought. Again, I am a Gascony fetishist, so maybe I always, that's a bit of an idiot fixer for me, but yeah, I'm amazed, you know, and I say, even in my own experience, sometimes I make this exact move and I think to myself, there's no possible way this isn't obvious, but there's something about this that just works over and over again, you know?
I think I might be wrong here. The other part of this is, why doesn't Jordan, France, Conk make Werther mover to Munich? Is this, he doesn't want to kill Germany now, but he wasn't sure if this was going to work. You know, I don't know, he's trying to hedge his bets a bit. And so now he can go to Germany and say, see, I could have killed you. I didn't. All you had to do was tap Ruhr. I'll help you back into Kiel. But of course, it all becomes problematic with Russia now working with England. And I don't know. I think he has to take Munich now because he's not going to get a build out of England. He has to take Munich. He has to build Fleet Brest. That has to happen.
I did find it really curious that if he's attacking England, he didn't take Holland.
He probably thought about it, and he didn't want to lose Ruhr.
Didn't want to lose Ruhr to Germany?
Yep.
He's tapping Munich, so he's worried that, what, Kiel's going to support to Munich, which would get broken anyway.
I wish I could have done my moveset.
There's something a little fishy going on here, because I do France's moves, his armies around Ruhr, Burr, and Belgium don't quite match the Western moves. I'm really curious about that. You know, for instance, if he wants to enlist German help, even without telling him in advance of the stab, why would he support into Munich in the spring? I mean, just to maybe he's cuddling up to Russia, or maybe, yeah, there's something.
This is why my test theory, I think, worked, because North Sea did not have to support Denmark. So I found that curious. I found the self-bounce in Sweden curious, you know, but fine. I can understand the reasons. It's just an
argument. Ed, have you ever noticed that when someone uses a word, you start using immediately?
Curious?
I said curious, and now you're saying curious a bunch. And then the other day, I said social capital, and then everyone started talking about social capital.
Everyone's saying.
So it might be the lawyer in me, because when I direct witnesses all the time, I'm always listening to what the witness says, and I'm using their language for them for the next question to try and vibe with them a bit. So maybe that's it.
I'll
change it. I find it interesting. How about that?
It's observation, yeah.
I wish I would have done my moveset by moving to Constantinople and moving Ionia into Greece with Serbian support. I mean, even if you don't bounce in Con, I mean, Greece retreats to Bulgaria, but you got 4 units on Bulgaria and a unit in Con. I mean, if he would have done it that way, then you'd have a disband and your fleet would be in Greece. Significantly better position, but
yeah, I think Austria wanted, quote, more flexibility with his fleet. But look, I think we agree that if the kids stick together, Lare and Josh, they can beat Grayson and Ewok here. But let's not pretend that this is going to be some easy fight.
No, it's much harder now.
You know, the Ewok and Grayson can tactic. They know tactics.
Yeah, but I mean, you're looking at taking Greece. Or walking into Bulgaria, or walking into Constantinople, it would have been a much easier kill.
Let me ask you this. It's another question I have. I think we can all agree Riaz is not going to get a fleet built in London unless he goes stone cold, balls to the wall, and doesn't move there because everyone thinks he's going to move there and gives Conk the guarantee into, you know, so Conk takes guarantee and fly.
You mean Liverpool?
The guaranteed, the uncontested convoy, he means.
Yeah, France has an uncontested convoy to Clyde. He's not going to move to Liverpool because he's worried about a bounce. Riaz really wants a fleet build, okay? And I don't know if he can hold on to Kiel in this situation. Because he has to disband it, and then we don't know what the moveset's going to be. Does he go to Russia and, like, trade Norway for Berlin, or does he say, look, I need this build, I got to cover Holland, I don't get something. Is he going to go up here? And would that be devastating?
Russia's the linchpin. It's all on Russia who they decide to support in the war.
I think Russia has to support England. Too many fleets around Scandinavia.
I'd be worried England's just going to try to take my centers right now to save themselves. This is why he should have moved to St. Petersburg, at least. I mean, it's a tough situation. I mean, England might have to betray Russia just to save themselves, right?
Well, I think England's going to ask and say, I could take it, but I really, really, really need it.
If you really need something, why don't you just have me support hold you in Kiel?
Also, if
still
you got to
cover
really...
Holland. Still got to cover Holland.
Let me get this straight. So let's say you're Russia, right?
Well, how about I support
and
Denmark?
England,
I move away from my shit.
Let's say you're Russia and England, you know, that power that's kind of threatening to you comes to you and says, oh my God, France, that natural geopolitical ally to you, is attacking me. I really, really need you to do X or I will be really screwed and you won't have any pressure on your northern front. What would you do? I mean... Like, why would Russia help them, right?
I don't know. I'd move Norway to Sweden, and I would take Berlin. And if he forces Norway, I'll ensure that I remove it from the board if it happens to be dislodged, and I'll build a fleet in response. So he could just walk into Sweden.
This is a very important point. This is, as another Cedric thing, you're thinking folds ahead, Keith, right? Which is, if you force Norway, Russia still is going to get A build. Maybe Norway can be disbanded and rebuilt.
Yeah, as a
fleet. And that's something England doesn't, which is why England can't do this without, I don't
know. England needed Germany. I really have to say this shows why. I mean, I'm not going to say my way of thinking is necessarily right here, but when you're in that Western Triangle, I really like when someone's down, I like to flip to them, you know? And
agreed.
Usually
really grateful. And it's actually three extra armies and no fleets against them at this point.
Exactly. And I think you went a little too hard against Germany here. I mean, I can see, I mean, this is again, you know, me channeling Riaz, but I can see the Riaz being, you know, doling out the centers, being, oh, we'll all go up to six together. We'll all, you know, me, Russia, France, look, we're all at six together. Like, my plan's working. Where then we'll all go to seven together and we'll each have a better, you know, the thing about Riaz, for better or for worse, is he really does try to create, I think, I again, Riaz, you know, I haven't gotten a single meta message yet. So if you want to send me one and correct me, it would really help my like shattered ego. But, you know, to me, I think what he would, when he proposes something, he says like, here's something where everyone can benefit up to a certain point. Right. So I think that that was his message. But I think he's in a little bit of trouble here. Yeah. I think he overextended. I don't think that this convoy into Clyde or the threat is the immediate threat, but just the fact that it makes him scramble back, that it opens up, it throws a wrench in his plans in the north, which is, I think, to keep the Russian centers as a reservoir that he could take quite quickly in a sprint to the end. It makes him completely dependent on Russia, who has a geopolitical interest against him. You know, he also made the mistake of like going with Russia instead of Germany, because that lets Turkey either die or die slowly, or at least, you know, go, you know, through 5-6 years of suffering. And you kind of need Turkey as a target in the other end of the board so that Russia has something to kind of beat their head on. You know, Austria is helping Russia, who's your geopolitical ally. Austria is usually your geopolitical ally. There's a lot going wrong with England here, which is tough, because Riaz really had set up a beautiful position, you know, up to this point, right? And I'm not saying he won't get out of it, but, you know, I actually think that Conk's move was quite astute, even if it was unpredictably predictable, apparently.
All right, let's wrap up with some questions here. Predictions, where does Austria retreat?
I would say I would want him to retreat to Apulia, but the way he's been playing, I'd say Tunis.
It's a really tough to make a... I'm going to say Tunis. I really see Apulia really... It's really 50-50 for me, my personal opinion. I would have a lot of trouble deciding on this move. I think Tunis offers a tiny bit more. The only worry I'd have is rustling France's feathers and having France come back down, though they are supposedly committed against England now. But yeah, I'll say Tunis.
I'm going to go with Tunis. Only
I like my fleet theory. Again, but if he
you know what? Fleet. It's a free center. And lightning strike 1 in 100 times, maybe you keep it, right? Nothing wrong with Tunis. Slows down, builds a fleet anyway. Next question, does Conk, brave Conk that we know, that we see do crazy brave moves all the time. I've seen the dude convoy to London. I've seen the guy take Marseille as Italy in 01. Will he just go directly to Liverpool, or will he take the easy route into Clyde?
I like the idea of going to Liverpool because I don't think that his plan... Again, this is a finals board. I think Conk, you know, the kind of daredevil Conk you're talking about, I think is regular season Conk. I think he's been in so many finals boards and has been a victim of the shifting incentives so many times that I think he actually, even though this seems like a really audacious move, and it is, I think that he will be quite happy to kind of take to roll the dice on Liverpool, but also keep his army safely on the continent. Just kind of slow Riaz's role, trust his diplomacy to iron things out again. Riaz is, I feel like, someone who is always willing to listen. And I think Conk will continue to get his aggression and audacious nature satisfied in speedboat games, which I hope to play with him shortly after we record this.
If England gets a bill and he gets in the Clyde, it's just either an instant disband or using NAO to just hold. It just seems really bad. I mean, using three units for a bounce in Liverpool seems bad too. But at the same time, you're holding up a bunch of dots. But what do you think about just moving into Norwegian and Channel?
I was thinking that too.
And just Gascony to Brest. I mean, that's a lot more pressure.
I agree. I mean, and also to block a potential move to the English Channel by Riaz.
Then you build in Brest, and then you can still hold Mid-Atlantic out.
Though, I mean, on the other hand, you could say, yeah, they could disband the army in Brest, and I mean, in Clyde, and then what does he do? He builds a fleet in Brest. Oh, I mean, yeah, but I agree, Stitches. I don't think that the obvious move will be made unless it's a multifold obvious move, right? Where it's so obvious that it becomes the unexpected.
So on a scale of 1 to 10 of likelihood of crazy things happening, Austria retreats to Tunis, and then we see in the fall, Greg switch with the AR, Turenian in Lyon, Tunis in Western Med, Justice Conk extends himself up against England. Will Greg join this AR's, let them focus on Turkey? Maybe we attack France here. Greg gets Venice back as part of the deal. Will that happen?
I think that if the fleet goes to the Adriatic, that might be happening.
Yeah, it'd have to go to Adriatic.
I had that thought in general that there might be something worked out between Austria and Italy here. But I haven't played with Greg, and I've observed him, and I've never actually seen him this far down. Like, how does he respond to this kind of situation? Do you guys have any idea? Like, is he someone who will cut a deal with his aggressor, right? Like, I mean, there's very different people, right? Like, Stitches is a great player, but he's an angry guy. Like, if I walked into Venice as Austria, there's no way he's working with me. Like, I've got to put him down. You know, it's like, I've got to take every single one of his centers, you know, if I'm going to do this to him. Some people, and I'm on the other end of things, I'm someone who would definitely be like, oh yeah, like, you can even keep Venice. Like, I didn't need that anyway. That's really a land center. Like, so I just wondering how you think Greg will respond to this.
I've seen Greg play down one time, and it wasn't his fault. Media Wars 1, oddly enough, playing Italy, took over a horrific Italian position, and I was France, and we were working together, and he played it very conservatively, just like you would expect Greg to do, and he made it to the end of the game, holding the stalemate line as Italy. But I don't think Greg works with anybody unless he has his home center back, unless he has Venice.
Gotcha.
He's one of those players, it's almost like, I'm not even talking to you until I have my home center back. When I have my home center back, we'll talk. But then it's not even a guarantee that he'll do anything after that.
Mm.
And I don't see Conk leaving Mid-Atlantic if there's a retreat to Tunis.
Well, that means the convoy is more likely.
Good point. You don't see this happen. Because you know there's going to be a retreat.
Question here. Russia's move of Ukraine to Romania. If you're in a real AR, Austria probably doesn't love that. Serbia's
convoy. It's got to be set up for convoy. Then he has to choose what's he going to block. You don't want to lose black. It's your only fleet. And Sevastopol wasn't a given. So it's the only place to deploy your army. So it's a must. It would have been much better had Bulgaria gone to Constantinople. Then you have a lot more options. But the Austrian play was a little subpar. A little more selfish.
I don't think the Austrian player is subpar. He didn't know that Turkey would convoy. So it all depends. I mean,
even if it didn't convoy, it would have retreated into Bulgaria. You'd have four armies on it, and you'd be in Constantinople.
Mm.
Unless they bounce there. But then
that's a good point. Yeah.
They'd still be gone, and Con would be open still.
Okay. Any other thoughts? I'm going to share some of Wardy's thoughts here, or I'm going to read them, and I'll let you comment on them. Well, Wardy, it's the middle of the night for Wardy.
All right, yeah.
He loves Germany's defense. He thinks this is the right move for AR. France probably saw that England could stab Russia at will and all but lock down the north. He felt he had to strike now.
Uh-huh.
Oh, did he think Riaz was convoying out this turn? That's on my... Italy has a chance to pick himself off the mat. These comments are very boring, Wardy. Wardy didn't like the bounce in Tyrolia. Let's see.
In Wardy's defense, he kind of needs us to massage him a lot before he can really, you know, produce.
You think he's like a woman who needs to get warmed up? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah. Like, it's just hard for him to go just from cold to sending you text comments like this, you know?
Yeah, well, you know, you are a G-spot man, as you've already said.
True. Hey, Wardy, if you need me to move to Gascony or Galicia for you, anytime.
All right. You guys have anything else on the season? Anything else you want to get off your chest? Cedric, I feel like we haven't given you enough room to express yourself. Anything else? Anything that you want
to
say?
More room to express myself. No, it's okay. I'll save it for my solo pun. No, I'm kidding. I feel like I really, for once, managed to get it off my chest, you know? And I'm glad that I was vindicated about the AR. So, and also, I guess I should say, Lowry, I declared you the people's champ. I put my blessing upon you. My blessing is bearing fruit. I mean, come on, send me a few meta messages. I'll help you out. I won't tell anyone, but I will help you, you know?
He probably doesn't even realize this show is happening.
Does he even... I don't know. They're a stoic people, you know.
They're stoic people. They kill them. All right.
They do. They're sorcerers. All the Norse people, they considered the Finns sorcerers.
All right, Keith. You've been kind of stoic tonight. Just man of wisdom. Few words, but they all have meaning. Give us your departing words here.
I already get some words in, but yeah, everything happened the way it should have happened. I think Ostrom has played a little bit, but still in a good position.
Did you ever realize that Keith is the middle child? I'm the older child. Cedric's the young child. Try to get in those punches. He's just some sweet sides. Keith's just like, let these two fight it out.
Yes. I just need to be right. I don't have to have the last word.
Oh, well, we'll give you the last word with that, my friend. All right. Thanks for a hilarious show. I hope this recorded. I'm actually having my doubts right now, but all right.
Fuck.
Oh, it was recording. Good to hear. Good night, guys.
Okay.
For a taste of your whiskey, I'll give you some advice. You got to know when to hold up, know when to fold up, know when to walk away, know when to run. You never count your money. When you're sitting at the table, there'll be time enough for count. When the dealing's done.